Good morning, everybody. This is Sean Copeland. Today is Saturday, November the 25th. I hope you didn't eat too much for Thanksgiving, and welcome to another brand new life-changing edition of the Kingdom Driven CEO. Today on the Kingdom Driven CEO, we are going to talk about God's performance review, okay? And I want to kind of give a little bit of context to this. So today is a big football day, okay? I think you would agree with me. If you're a big football fan, there are all kinds of rivalries today. Michigan plays Ohio State. OSU plays BYU to see if they make it into the Big 12 championship. There's just tons. There were some good games yesterday. And so it is a great time to be a football fan. And one of the things that you notice in football is you either win or you lose. There's not really any credit given to somebody playing a good game and not winning. So we tend to live that way in our lives. We think that life is about winning and losing. And when we make mistakes and we fall short, we get down on ourselves. And I'm going to tell you a little bit today about God's performance review and the way that He really views us. And let me read this to you from our devotional. I am pleased with you, my child. Allow yourself to become fully aware of my pleasure shining upon you. You don't have to perform well in order to receive my love. In fact, a performance focus will pull you away from me towards some sort of Pharisaism. This can be a subtle form of idolatry, worshiping your own good works. It can also be a source of deep discouragement when your works don't measure up to your expectations. Shift your focus from your performance to my radiant presence. The light of my love shines on you continually, regardless of your feelings or behavior. Your responsibility is to be receptive to this unconditional love. Thankfulness and trust are your primary receptors. Thank me for everything. Trust in me at all times. These simple disciplines will help keep you open to my loving presence. So today, let's talk a little bit about this and how God is pleased with you no matter how you perform. And I know this is a tough one to understand. I get it. I am hyper performance oriented. So this devotional is being spoken straight back to me. But we have to remember that God's love is everlasting. It is unconditional. We don't have to work for it. He does not want it to be about works. Now, here is why I know this is true, okay? I'm going to tell you a story. Last year, we were playing in the state finals for baseball. And, you know, we play all year long. We travel all over the country. We practice. We spend hours and hours in the batting cage and pitching. And so we were down by one run. We had runners on second and third. Finley was up to bat. It was against one of our biggest rivals. We had two outs. So basically, if he struck out, the game was over. If we got a hit, we won the game. And you all know he has had tremendous success. He hit a grand slam in the national finals down in Dallas and pitched a great game. And he's gotten all kinds of accolades. But in this particular situation, he struck out. And we lost the game. And it was a tough one. And it was a tough one for him to take. And I want you to think about this for just a moment. What was I thinking at the time that he struck out? Was I thinking, oh my gosh, I've wasted all these hours of practice. If he would have just practiced harder, this wouldn't have happened. You know, I can't believe he let me down. I can't believe he let the team down. No, I wasn't thinking any of those things. I just wanted to make everything okay. I just wanted him to know how much I loved him and how he was not defined by that moment. Same thing with my middle daughter. Kennedy recently took the PSAT test, and it didn't go as well as she had hoped. It went well, but not national merit finalist well. So she was all bummed out, and I needed her to know she was not defined by that moment. And my oldest daughter, Emery, has applied for some things in college that she didn't get, and she feels less worthy because she didn't get those, and I needed her to know that she is not defined by how those interviews go or what those people making the selections thought. That did not define her. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." It's not because of what we do. And I want to ask you, how many of you struggle with performance-based love? You don't feel good enough because you didn't perform well, or maybe you're on the other end of this and you withhold performance from a loved one because they don't perform up to your expectations. We have seen this in our family, particularly with my grandfather and father. If my dad didn't act a certain way, my grandfather would withhold love. I've seen this with other family members as well. And it is not healthy, and it is not right, and it is not how God looks at you and me. We had Angela, this was several years ago, we had gone down to Dallas to the Four Seasons for a long weekend. And while we were gone, some of our friends, led by Angela's mother-in-law and Mark and Carol Pate, all jumped in and did a little home makeover on our house. They redid our bedroom and painted it and got new bedspread. I mean, all kinds of things. It was amazing. And when we got back home, all this was done. And I struggled because the gift was so wonderful. And I did not feel worthy. I did not like the fact that they did so much for us that we did not deserve. We have to get past this. In Ephesians 3:16, it says, "I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." But how many of you have a father or a mother or a sibling or a boss or a child who simply cannot be pleased? I know of people who are scarred their entire life because they don't feel good enough. I think this is a huge reason for the confusion that occurs in people's lives right now. I think they're looking for acceptance and love, and they just don't know where to find it. Everybody wants to feel unconditionally loved. And the problem is, as we talked about earlier, we live in a performance-based society. This is a tough one for me because I am a pleaser big time. My dad was demanding because his dad was super demanding. And it, you know, it almost becomes like a competition. Can you perform well enough to meet their expectations? Well, now I don't have that issue. Dad and I are best friends. My parents and I, my sibling, my Shanna and I are all best of friends. But I still struggle with feeling good enough. And guys, we have to let this go. We cannot let other people determine our self-worth. We must embrace God's love for us with no expectations. We did not earn it, and we cannot lose it. Psalm 62:8 says, "Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge." If you're on the other end of this, withholding approval from someone, you got to stop. This is a form of control that is not healthy and shouldn't happen, and we need to love our children, our siblings, our parents, and be their biggest fans no matter what. I just saw, I was at a banquet recently where caregivers were recognized, and I saw how they loved the people that they were caring for unconditionally. The recipient of their care didn't earn it. They weren't perfect. They were given this care because of love. I've had so many people help me in my life when I didn't deserve it. Dr. Jim Halligan, my buddy Chip C., Brent Curry, Doug Tippins, Joe Williams, Nick Vujicic, Tracy Williams. These are all friends of mine who have come through for me and given me something major in my life when I did not deserve it. Do you love your kids more when they succeed? Of course you don't. You probably love them more when they fail and you want to make everything okay for them. That is how God feels about you and me. Back in 2009, the biggest breakthrough of my life came when I learned that God was truly in control. I could only do my best, and the results were completely up to Him. He loved me the same, no matter what. Let's rest in His amazing love and soak it up today. Let's learn to receive. Let it give us energy and confidence, because we know that no matter how we perform, no matter how, you know, what other people think about us, God loves us so much. And I want to close it by telling you about a dream that I had a couple of years ago, which really helped me to understand this. I was reading a book called The Cure, and The Cure talks about the fact that we live with these lies. We live not understanding who God is, and we live not understanding who we are. And the book is phenomenal if you get a chance to read it. But that night after I finished reading the book, I was asleep and I had this very, very vivid dream. And Jesus and I were together in a field. And my perception was that I was on one side, Jesus was on the other side, and between us was all of my sin and shame and mistakes and things that I have done wrong. And believe me, there are many. So there was this huge pile of stuff. And I thought I had to work through that huge pile to get to Jesus on the other side. The only way I could have a close relationship with Him was if I cleaned up my act, if I did better, if I performed better. Jesus walked around that big pile, and He gave me a big hug, and He put His arm around me, and we looked at that big pile together, and He goes, "Man, that's a whole lot of stuff, isn't it?" And I said, "Yes." I said, "Jesus, I'm so sorry." I said, I want to do better. I'm trying to do better." And He looked me in the eyes and said, "Listen, we're going to work on this together. I don't love you because of your perfection. I love you because you are my son." And I knew you weren't going to be perfect. I knew you were going to make mistakes. And we're not going to tolerate all this stuff, but we're going to just work through it together. Me and you together. That is the message I want us to hear today. That's how He feels about you. He's not judging you. He's not angry with you. His performance review is not all negative because of what you have done. He loves you. He wants you to do better, and he wants to work with you to become the person that He knows you can be. So please bow with me today as we close. Dear Heavenly Father, coming off of a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday, we just want to give you thanks. Thank you for provision. Thank you for our beautiful families. Thank you for giving your son to die on the cross for us. Father, help us to accept your love. Help us to know that it is not performance-based. Help us to realize that we don't have to be perfect for you to love us, and that it doesn't really matter what other people think, that we live for an audience of one. We love you so much, and I just pray that as we move into this holiday season, I know it can be hectic. I know it can be stressful. Help us to turn to you and to accept your love. Help us to take this truth into our worlds to be a light unto others. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, everybody, we will close out today, but thank you for joining us for this wonderful edition of the Kingdom Driven CEO, and I'll be back with you next Saturday. Have a great week.